பண்ணுவீங்களா என்ன பண்ணிட்டு இருக்கீங்க? Professor Muthukumar to make to arrangement at such a short notice. And we have already installed one unit of EECP in the third floor for patient with refractory angina and heart failure. Today, my presentation would be to elicit what is EECP, mechanism of action, clinical outcome, and patient selection. I will try to be as brief as possible so that I can able to complete it in 20 to 25 minutes. I graduated from Karnataka, then I was doing my internship in Stanley for 1 year. Then I studied in Jipmer for non-PG for 1 year. Then I went to took an USML, I went to US, where I joined in Stony Brook. And there I wrote an article on EECP which got accepted in American Journal of Cardiology. So the company recruited me as a clinical guy, and I worked with Stony Brook University and FDA to give objective evidence for the treatment so that it can be cleared by FDA and the insurance company. So some of the papers which I published also, I'll just give you a glimpse. So if you look at here, enhanced external counter pulsation, it's a non-invasive, atraumatic, in the sense it is neither an interventional procedure nor a medical management. It's a device-based treatment for patients with angina and heart failure. The treatment is already approved by FDA, and it is also covered by medical insurance in US. And recently in 2012, the treatment was incorporated in the Chief Minister's scheme, and it has been reimbursed for the patient, eligible patient who are called refractory angina and heart failure. So before getting into the what is EECP and actual mechanism of action, I just want you to freshen up something on the basic hemodynamics of cardiac circulation. If you look at here, the aortic pressure and left ventricular pressure, whenever there is an increase in left ventricular pressure that actually happened during the systolic phase, if you look at the down, the systolic phase, the blood flow into the coronary vascular bed is very, very minimal, which is only 20% of the circulation. And the maximum coronary filling takes place only in the diastolic phase. So it has been speculated and also has been intensively researched, any treatment which can push the blood into the coronary circulation during the filling place or the diastolic phase would have the immense benefit to the myocardium. Because in the systolic phase, the myocardium contracts as well as the coronary arteries are squeezed in the wall so that the blood flow is very minimal. So this concept was already utilized what we call as the intra-aortic balloon pump. So they have a maximum diastolic pressure so that augment the coronary filling so that the coronary vascular bed is flooded with the blood. And if you want to treat any patient with cardiovascular disease, if you want to make it very, very simple as possible, it comes under two categories, which is a balance between demand and supply. So either you can able to take the demand away from the myocardium so that let the myocardium function with the less energy, or you have to improve the supply to the myocardium. So if you look at reducing the demand or afterload, which is achieved by all the medical management we do, like a nitrate, calcium channel blocker, ACE inhibitor or ARB. But if you want to increase the supply to the myocardium, the only way you can achieve is by an interventional procedure. Either you have to graft, which is a bypass surgery, or you have to open the vessel, which is an angioplasty. So these are the two techniques which can improve the myocardial perfusion directly. So it is always imagination or what we call like a revolutionary idea from the any interventionalist or any researcher is there any treatment which can do both in a device wise. So that is intra-aortic balloon pump. But unfortunately, intra-aortic balloon pump can be inserted into the aorta only a couple of hours or a couple of days. It cannot be left for a longer period of time. And it is the only treatment available for the cardiogenic shock when the myocardial salvage has to take place. So EECP is the same as intra-aortic balloon pump, non-invasive, which can be used in a chronic phase. So that is how it has been positioned as a treatment for chronic stable angina. So what actually EECP does? Enhanced external counter pulsation, as I said, is completely a non-invasive procedure. So it uses three sets of cuff in the lower region, lower calf, lower thigh, and upper thigh region. The patient is lying down on the treatment table where it is hooked to the ECG. So the ECG, as if in the intra-aortic balloon pump, can able to find out exactly where the diastolic phase and exactly where the systolic phase take place. So during the diastolic phase, where you can able to fill the coronaries, because the coronary filling happens during that period, we give a pressure of around 300 millimeter mercury pressure. This amount of pressure is translated into increasing the circulation into the coronary vascular bed. So this increase in blood supply, what it does to the coronary vascular bed is a hypothesis which I am going to explain as a mechanism of action. So the patient, as the treatment starts, comes for 35 days. Every day, 1 hour continuously for 35 days. During during the 35 days, is getting to pump the blood from the lower leg towards the coronary. So the coronary flow is augmented. So as a synonymous, what I can say is, it is equivalent to a patient who cannot even walk for 2 minutes, actually is acting a makeup of a jogging. So that amount of blood supply is increased into the coronary vascular bed without patient is put on into any effort. So what is the actual mechanism of action? As I said before, EECP is a form of non-invasive intra-aortic balloon pump. Intra-aortic balloon pump is positioned in the aorta. EECP cuffs are positioned in the legs. So here, if you see, there are three sets of cuffs in the calf, lower thigh, and upper thigh region. Exactly during the diastolic phase, the cuff squeezes the leg. So there are two compartments. One is an arterial compartment, one is the venous compartment. So it gives the compression to the arteries as well as veins. So here there is a differentiation. In intra-aortic balloon pump, there is no venous component is involved. Here in EECP, there is a venous component is involved. When it is compressed, the arterial blood goes in a retrograde direction. Because the aortic valve is closed, because it's timed exactly during the diastolic phase, the blood enters into the coronary vessel with a higher velocity and higher pressure. So when this higher velocity and higher pressure of blood enter into the coronary vasculature for a prolonged period of time, up to 35 days, it stimulates what we call as collateralization or angiogenesis. It can stimulate new vessel formation, and also it can able to open up the dormant collateral which is already existing into the vascular bed. And second is a systolic phase. When the heart is ready to pump, the cuffs deflate. So what it happens is, it creates a drastic reduction in the peripheral vascular resistance. So the heart can able to pump blood easily into the dilated vessel, as if it is taken a dose of nitrates. So basically, it reduces the afterload and increases the supply. So the question frequently asked when the FDA get the clearance for EECP for 1999 is, you put a pressure on the leg. Do you have any evidence to show the amount of pressure you're putting on the lower leg actually translated into increased pressure into the central hemodynamics? So it's only in 2008, one surgeon, Michael Andrew from Florida, he used radial approach, put the catheter and put it in the intracoronary and start actual pressure tracing during counter pulsation. To the surprise, if you say in the baseline, you can see there is a systolic dichrotic notch and down sloping diastole, and they start up applying a pressure 100, 150, 200, 250, 300 in the lower leg. And to the surprise, what they find out, whatever pressure you applied in the lower limb is actually translating into the pressure into the central hemodynamics. If you see here, the diastolic pressure as you start getting in baseline 100, 150, in 150 you can see the diastolic pressure slowly coming up. When the pressure reaches up to 250, you can see the diastolic pressure or the diastolic curve is double than the systolic curve. So this is what we call as a diastolic augmentation. So you are augmenting the blood pressure into the coronary circulation during the diastolic phase. And to the surprise, it's much better than what intra-aortic balloon pump can achieve. Because here we are using the vasculature and pushing more volume than IABP can do. And incidentally, if you look at the systolic amplitude, you can see the systolic amplitude is coming down. So this is what the effect we call as afterload reduction or unloading of the left ventricle. So the left ventricle is unloaded, so the demand is reduced, so the oxygen consumption in the myocardium reduced, and the supply is increased. So both the main criteria for treatment is angina is achieved during every cycle of EECP. And this is a curve to show how much of diastolic pressure is increased. It is almost 92% increase in the diastolic pressure and 150% increase in the diastolic velocity. So overall, the mechanism of action is increased blood supply to the myocardium is translated into the new vessel formation, which we call angiogenesis. And also because of the sheer volume of blood which is moving up and down in the body, as if the patient is doing exercise, what it does is it started improving the endothelial function. So the endothelium naturally started secreting more nitric oxide and endothelium level falls. And we always remember endothelial function is a predictor of outcome and also predictor of mortality irrespective of your coronary stenosis. You might have a 50% or 90% stenosis, but you have a LV, you have an endothelial dysfunction, your chance of getting myocardial infarction or unstable angina is higher. So this treatment also improves your endothelial function, as if you are doing an aggressive exercise. But actually, this is a passive exercise without putting you on any effort. So second is, when I said angiogenesis, new vessel is formation. New vessel formation is a very, very complicated process, and books and books has wrote, there are a lot of books on it. To make it very simple, there are two ways to assess whether you have achieved angiogenesis or not. One is we call as a myocardial perfusion scanning, thallium scan, or a PET scan. So in 1992 to 2003, our group did the maximum of around 200 patients. The patient pre and post myocardial perfusion scan show a significant improvement of perfusion to the ischemic area after 35 days of EECP. That is an indirect evidence to show the collateralization taken places. So this is our paper which got us into the insurance companies in US. I just want to point it out to you. To assess the patient's collateralization, number one, you have to ask them to do a treadmill. Let's say he do a treadmill for 4 minutes. After 35 sessions of ECP, ask him to do the same 4 minutes. Even though his exercise capacity is improved, if you keep the workload same and do the perfusion scanning, 83% of the patient, there is a significant improvement in perfusion, which can be directly related to angiogenesis. Or push him harder. Ask him to do as much exercise as possible after treatment. Still, about 54% has the improvement in perfusion. This shows collateralization is already occurring in the myocardium. So these are all the perfusion scan which we did, couple of patients in front end. You can see pre and post. The ejection fraction jumped from 30 to 42% because of the global improvement in the blood flow. And also you can see the scanning, that the bright area shows us the blue area shows the ischemia and the bright red shows the flow. You can see pre and post. Visually, you can definitely see there is a significant improvement in perfusion. And finally, it is always a stumbling block because the gold standard, if you want to say there is the angiogenesis taking place, the gold standard is the collateral flow index, which can be done by the catheterization. So until 2010, there is no study to directly show collateralization. In 2010 and 12, there is two groups. One is the angiogenesis group in Germany, another in Switzerland. Both did the same protocol. They took one group of patients with ECP with no pressure. So they give very low pressure, another one with an active counter pulsation, and they were able to show the patient who undergone active counter pulsation, there is a significant increase in collateral flow index. That shows angiogenesis is happening. So the proof for angiogenesis, the growth factor increase and also collateral flow index and myocardial perfusion all clearly shows beyond doubt new vessel can be stimulated, flow can be increased in the myocardium without putting a stent or a graft by ECP alone. But patient selection is a paramount important, which I'm going to show you a little bit later. So again, in 2010, the Cardiology Journal of India has reviewed EECP for patients with refractory angina and heart failure. So if I put on EECP, what is the outcome? As every physician, we want to know after applying EECP, what is an outcome on this patient? Would they be able to sustain the benefit for the longer time? So already there is a 3-year follow-up study has already done, which clearly shows even after 3 years, 75% of the patients were able to retain the clinical benefit which they got after post-ECP. And there are some of the trials which I don't want to go into detail. All of them have shown more than 5,000 patients has been followed up to 6 months, 1 year, 2 year, and 3 year. All has shown around 70 to 85% of the patients were able to retain the benefit even after 3 years of the counter pulsation. And second is angina is a heart failure. Heart failure is because what we call as a systemic failure. It is not only a myocardial dysfunction, but also the systemic failure because of the endothelial dysfunction. Here again, patient with heart failure. Were able to reduce the emergency visit after ECP, and almost 83% were able to reduce the hospitalization time after post ECP. If you follow them for 2 years, patient with severe LV dysfunction less than 35%. And we all know that our mortality is very high, rehospitalization is very high. But after ECP, it is not a randomized trial, it is an epidemiological survey which shows almost 2 years follow up, 83% of them are alive, and almost 70% of them have not visited the hospital, which shows EECP significantly have an effect on the patient with heart failure. So let's finally go for a couple of slides on patient selection, as we are very important. EECP can be given as a primary utilization for a patient with angina and heart failure who are on maximal medical management. Still, they have angina and poor quality of life. And again, they are not a candidate for interventional procedure because of a lot of other reasons. The reasons has been listed below. Patient refused. If they have a diffuse vessel disease, where stenting is not possible. Or the target lesion is inaccessible. High risk for surgery. Or patient with comorbid illness which have a high incidence for risk while proceeding the interventional procedure. Or patient with severe LV dysfunction. So this is a FDA list. The recommended use for ECP is stable, unstable, and heart failure. Indication minimum there should be a class 2 and class 4. Whether it is NYHA or CCS, they have symptomatic irrespective of maximal medical management, and they have been evaluated and they have seen to be not a candidate for interventional procedure. And some of the contraindications are very similar to what you do with the intra-aortic balloon pump. You should not have an aneurysm, you should not have a valvular disease, or you should evaluate them for deep vein thrombosis. So to summarize all, the mechanism of action is ECP significantly improve the myocardial blood flow by collateralization and angiogenesis, and also it has a significant improvement in endothelial function. If you look at the clinical evidence, more than 85% to 90% of the patient, there is a significant improvement in quality of life. And the improvement in quality of life they got post ECP is sustainable even after 3 to 5 years of completion of the treatment. And also, the treatment has shown to be safe and effective even in patients with high risk for interventional procedure and also who are comorbid illness. So finally, our focus is, most of the focus is on ischemic heart disease, or we call it as a coronary artery disease. But the focus is, it is ischemic heart disease and coronary artery disease are a subgroup. As a whole, we have to look at it as a cardiovascular disease. So improving the myocardial perfusion and reducing the afterload, which are on the effect on the systemic circulation, is much more important than only focusing on the coronary artery itself. Thank you. So what is the advantage and disadvantage of ECP when compared to IAPP? So in my slides, I have clearly shown ECP is very comparable to the IAPP on its effect on the cardiovascular disease. So if you look at IAPP is life-saving in acute event, in a cardiogenic shock. And ECP has no trial has been done on ECP. That is why where IAPP fail is in the chronic state. If you have a chronic angina, you're not going to expect to put IAPP to increase the myocardial perfusion. ECP is a safe alternative for a patient with chronic stable angina, where the effect of IAPP can be provided by ECP into this chronic patient, where the myocardial perfusion improves. Number second, IAPP does not have any effect on the venous system. Two, ECP has an effect of, because we are compressing the leg, not on the aorta. So we are also increasing the preload. So increasing the preload preload in patient with right heart failure or patient with have a high pulmonary artery pressure, PA pressure more than 50 or 60 is dangerous because it may cause a pulmonary edema. So IABP does not have this because it is not even affecting your venous return. But because it increases the venous return in a patient with stable heart failure, EECP can improve the cardiac output and the patient feels very better even after 5 sessions of EECP. Yeah, the role of EECP in acute coronary syndrome. The indication in FDA clearly says EECP because it is similar to IABP, it is also a treatment for cardiogenic shock and acute myocardial infarction. But unfortunately, so far, there is no trial has done on acute coronary syndrome. But actually, there is one trial, it's going on in Germany, in patients who come, as we talk about the balloon to bedtime. Patient come in, so you want to push in your the kinetic streptokinase into the circulation. At the same time, you always remember when a patient have low blood pressure, low cardiac output, whatever you are pushing, because of the sluggish flow of the circulation, the endless circulation, the drug might not reach the target. So there is one study to find out if you put EECP along with thrombolytic, can we be able to have a higher perfusion when compared with only thrombolytic. Other than that, there is no studies available, and probably next year, June, this study is going to be published. Yes, sir. Possible. So it is in patient with low output, even if you put the thrombolytic, it might not reach the target. So it will be given as an assist, like a ventricular assist device. It can assist the circulation to reach the thrombolytic, where the thrombolytic has to go. How long improvement lost in your study? Right now, there was a registry in US in Pennsylvania. They are following up the patient. The maximum number of years they have followed is up to 7 years. So they have shown in 7 years, almost 65 to 70% of the patient, they have retained the benefit without undergoing a repeat procedure. In US, the insurance companies allow the patient to go for EECP after 3 years to improve the myocardial perfusion. So definitely, the patient who we are talking about is inoperable group. So in that patient, sustaining the benefit to 3 to 5 years, we have a good quality of life and have a sustained decrease in the medical input of the patient. So I would say the follow-up of 5 to 7 years, the treatment benefit could be sustained. Thank you, sir. When ECP for first introduced, the first contraindication is heart failure. Because they thought, because it is going to affect the venous return, it is going to cause pulmonary edema and worsen the heart failure. But unfortunately, later from our epidemiological trial, it came up to say ECP is the treatment for heart failure. But hemodynamically, we could look, there is also one study which didn't show up. When you put a pressure of 300 millimeter in the leg, the preload increase in patient with heart failure. Then what happened? The right heart pressure increase, pulmonary wedge pressure increase, and pulmonary edema develops. But if because ECP reduced the afterload significantly much better than IABP, this flow which is going into the pulmonary started shifting into systemic because of the drastic reduction in afterload. So here, whenever we take a patient with low ejection fraction, we make sure the pressure we are applying is high, so the afterload is achieved. So if the afterload reduction is achieved significantly, you might not have a pulmonary edema. But if you don't achieve the afterload, the chances of pulmonary edema is very high. So it's a treatment we have trained our doctors and therapists how to reduce the afterload significantly during the treatment so that to avoid patient to go for a heart failure. Heart failure. Refractory angina. The heart failure improvement has been shown, sir. I mean, if you don't put the myocardium into definitely, sir. If you look at our data. Yes, sir, that's why. Let's say if a patient with 35% ejection fraction, now we are putting counter pulsation. Definitely, as you contemplate, the preload will increase, right atrial pressure will increase, and then pulmonary wedge pressure increase and pulmonary edema happens. But ECP has a tremendous effect on the afterload. So it also increases the cardiac output. And if your afterload reduction is significant, the deflation of the cuff timing is kept correctly, you might not develop the pulmonary edema. In fact, your cardiac output can be increased. So, in our data of 5,000 patients, 80% of them have triple vessel disease with LV dysfunction. So, in this group only we have shown that is how the FDA is cleared for heart failure. we give oxygen. But nariya patients ninga pannum bodhu and the PA pressure of 50 irukkum bodhu after ECP it will drop. So the placebo effect, which is always there in any medical device management. So you put any device or you put any intervention, there is always a question of what we call as the placebo effect. So if you want to say my treatment does not have any placebo effect, means a randomized trial is a must. If you don't have a randomized trial, and even if you say 90% of the patient did improve quality of life, they can walk larger, again, the chances of placebo effect is almost 60. But ECP right now has 7 randomized control trial to show the same patient come for ECP with no pressure has no improvement at all. Only the patient who undergone active counter pulsation have a sustained effect. So I would say the placebo effect may be 10 to 15%, but not as much as 60 or 65%, which is related to the device. Because we have also shown some of the objective evidence like ejection fraction improvement, reduction in BNP, improvement in myocardial perfusion, and improvement in collateral flow index. So these are all some of the objective evidence to show diastolic augmentation. So this case also I was discussing how the diastolic augmentation has improved in one patient. We did the 15 minutes. In patient with heart failure, the main complaint is fatigue, lack of appetite, and extreme tiredness. In ECP, what happened when you push the blood, within the third day he would say, I feel better. It has nothing to do with your cardiac, nothing to do with angiogenesis. It's just the improvement in cardiac output which is given for a sustained benefit. So the tiredness, all these things goes off within 3 days just because his blood flow is increasing, which he can achieve if he can able to walk 15 minutes every day. The only problem in heart failure is they cannot even walk for 2 minutes. So this could be augmented as increasing in the working capacity by increasing in cardiac output. Pulmonary hypertension, sir, if the pulmonary hypertension is more than 50, we don't do ECP. Because pulmonary hypertension is one condition, if the inflation and deflation time is not done absolutely correct, there is a chance of going for pulmonary edema. Yeah, 60 pulmonary hypertension, but we are doing all the patients now. With 60 also, we give oxygen to the patient and we monitor the pH. Yeah. Elevated pulmonary hypertension, we may have to provide oxygen It's not a contraindication, but you have to be careful. RV dysfunction is something difficult. And what we do is, if they have a dilated LV more than 6, COPD, no. But we have a lot of studies, some of the nephrologists are referring because, no. In patient with contraindication, if you have a severe aortic regurgitation, then it is absolute contraindication. If you have a mild to moderate, we can do, but any severe valvular condition might be a contraindication. Not studied, sir. It's a gray area, yeah.
Increases
and the patient LV function improves, and maximum 5 to 10 kgs of reduction is weight also has been mentioned in the literature. But reduction is because of the fluid overload has been corrected, not because of any fat or anything has reduced. So in a heart failure patient, there is a weight reduction because they are overloaded with the fluid, which you could achieve by pushing a diuretic also. So if they are resistant to the diuretic dosage, certain hospitals are using EECP to increase the urine output. Of hospitalization. All the consent form will be taken inside the center after the patient is referred to the EECP. No, we will put a medical officer who is a medical person who will do a counseling and take a consent form. Doctors, yes. Doctors, they, what the consent form, our doctor also will sign that the consent has taken along with the patient or patient first degree relative. Deep vein thrombosis is one of the relative contra, not absolute contra, relative contraindication for EECP. So theoretically there is a chance if you have a big thrombus, it can dislodge and causes a pulmonary infarct. But even patient with deep vein thrombosis, we have not got any patient who have a deep vein thrombosis because it is very difficult to screen. Most of the patients, they may say the clarification pain and they may have a thrombus. No case has been recorded, but if you see a patient with deep vein thrombosis, we may better reject them for ECP because there is a remote chance it can cause pulmonary infarct. In the sense, the amount of blood flow increases, the diastolic, for example, if you ask a patient to improve the diastolic augmentation as shown, he should be running for 10 kilometers to reach that amount of augmentation. Where no cardiac patient or no normal patient can do, or even a subject who has no coronary artery can do. So ECP, we achieve such a high amount of augmentation. Even in cardiac rehab, if you put a patient on a slowly on a treadmill, you are not going to achieve this much of augmentation. So I would not say directly, but combining ECP with cardiac rehab have a significant effect, which we are actually doing in our own center in Raipeta. After 15 sessions of ECP, the patient who are doing only one or two meds will start doing 5 to 6 meds. And we will ask them to sustain these higher meds during the completion of the treatment and during the follow-up period. So I think there is a great potential to combine ECP with cardiac rehab. But I would say ECP is a higher form of a cardiac rehab rather than a similar to cardiac rehab. See, most of the, as doctor said, most of the patient with cardiovascular disease, if you have a stenosis in coronary artery, atherosclerosis is not only affecting the coronary artery, the entire vascular system. So they may also have a peripheral vascular disease. But if the peripheral vascular disease is so severe, if the iliofemoral junction itself is obstructed, then whatever amount of pressure you put in the leg, it is not going to translate into the aorta and into the coronary arteries. But if there is a peripheral artery disease, and when you do a counter pulsation, if there is even a minor augmentation as a treatment progress, the blood flow also significantly improves and the endothelial function improves, peripheral vascular disease also a little bit.
Thank you.